Leia here from leiaforsci.com, and in this video, we're going to look at acetals, hemiacetals, ketals, and hemiketals from the reaction overview to a simple shortcut so you can easily get the products or reactants on exams. Acetal sounds like a scary topic because of the mechanism, but if you understand the steps, it's actually not as difficult as you think. A quick Google search tells us that an acetal is the condensation of an aldehyde, which we have here as a carbonyl, with two alcohols. But actually, when you're looking at the topic of acetals, you're technically looking at four different intermediates or products. We have an acetal or hemiacetal, a ketal or hemiketal. So what does it mean and what's the difference between them? In this video, we'll do a quick overview of the reaction so you understand what's going on along with a shortcut, and then in the subsequent videos, we'll look at mechanisms for acetal-ketal formation, as well as using acetals as protecting groups for advanced synthesis reactions. This reaction starts with a carbonyl that gets attacked with an alcohol, which is an oxygen nucleophile, at the carbonyl carbon. We can start out with an aldehyde or with a ketone. When the oxygen nucleophile attacks, we break the carbonyl so that the oxygen is still bound along with the incoming alcohol. Reacting this with one more alcohol will ultimately displace the OH group and give us a second OR on the molecule. When starting with an aldehyde, the final product still has an H and two OR groups. When starting with a ketone, the final product has two carbons and two OR groups. Let's also pay attention to what we lost. Every time we added an OR, we had to cut an H off the alcohol. So that's one hydrogen, two hydrogen, and of course the initial oxygen that we lost, which means both reactions will also have water as a side product. So what do we have here? Technically, this entire class of reactions is called acetal, but what we're actually looking at is an aldehyde reacting first with one alcohol to give us a half a product, or a hemiacetal, then reacting with another alcohol to give us a full acetal. If, however, you start with a ketone and react it with one alcohol, you get a half, not quite acetal, you get a hemiketal. And if you react the hemiketal with another alcohol, you get a full ketal. The difference being an aldehyde starting molecule will give you an acetal product. A ketone starting molecule will give you a ketal product. Some professors will lump all of this together and simply call it the acetal topic, and they will call the ketals an acetal. So how do we justify that? I want you to imagine that you're referring to different types of living organisms. There's feline, which would refer to tigers and lions and cats. There's canine, which would refer to all types of dogs. And then there's man, that refers to humans. Does it mean that man only refers to male humans? No, we're simply classifying humans as man, but it technically includes male and female. So think of acetal as man, as the overall category, but it technically includes both the acetal from the aldehyde starting molecule and the ketal from the ketone starting molecule. Note that both of these reactions are reversible. If you're trying to identify a molecule, here's how to quickly recognize them. When you have a carbon that has a hydrogen and two OR groups attached, that's how you recognize an acetal. If you have a carbon with two R groups attached and two ORs, that is how you recognize a ketal. But if the carbon that has two oxygens attached has an OH and an OR, that's your hemi. If there's a hydrogen, it's a hemiacetal. If there are two R groups, it's a hemiketal. Even though we show the hemiacetal and hemiketal intermediates, these reactions, while reversible, will prefer one way or the other. The one stable hemi intermediate is a cyclic compound, for example, glucose. In this drawing of D-glucose, we have a heterocyclic ring because of that oxygen. But if you look at this carbon over here called the anomeric carbon, you'll recognize that carbon is bound to two oxygen atoms. One is an OH group, the other is an OR group, but there's also a hydrogen. When you see carbon with hydrogen, OH and OR. The hydrogen tells us it came from an aldehyde. The OH and OR tells us it's a hemi, making this a hemiacetal, a very stable hemiacetal. Going back to the reactions, notice that we have double-headed arrows to show that it's in equilibrium. But this is tricky. In most cases, equilibrium for an aldehyde will favor the acetal, but with a ketone will not favor the ketal, it will favor the ketone. If you specifically want to drive the reaction in one direction, remember Le Chatelier's principle. If we add a reactant, we push the reaction forward. If we remove a product, we also push the reaction forward. This means that if the reaction takes place in alcohol, it does drive the reaction forward. Or if we do something like remove water from the products, we'll keep pulling the reaction forward. And the reverse is also true. If we remove alcohol or add product, the reaction would favor the reactants, pushing it in the reverse direction. In the next video, we'll look at the mechanism, but what if you simply need to identify reactants or products for short answer questions on your exam? Say we have a starting ketone reacting in an acid-catalyzed methanol solution. We'll just show H plus for the catalyst, but this could be HCl or paratoluene sulfonic acid, just write H plus. The product is going to have two OR groups attached, in this case 2OCH3, and of course a water molecule side product. If you're given a reactant and you need the product, here's what you do. You simply cut off the carbonyl oxygen, because that comes off as water. You cut off the two hydrogens from alcohol, because that comes off with water, and you add the OR group, whatever that oxygen is carrying, to the carbon that holds the carbonyl, which is exactly what we see here. We have the starting carbon chain and the two OR groups. This works no matter how complex your starting material or your alcohol. In this case, we have cyclohexanone, so we cut off the oxygen. We're reacting it in an isopropyl solution, so we cut off the hydrogen. Redraw your carbon chain, and the carbon that used to hold the carbonyl will now get two bonds to oxygen. On the oxygen, simply add the alcohol's carbon chain, in this case an isopropyl group and an isopropyl group. A similar shortcut works if you want to reverse the reaction. Say we're starting with an acetal, or in this case technically a ketal, and we want to know the starting carbonyl and alcohols. Identify that acetal or ketal carbon, the carbon that has two bonds to OR. Draw a carbonyl on that carbon and break the bonds that bind it to the OR groups. For every OR you cut off, simply add a hydrogen to reform the alcohol. What does that give us? We have the carbon chain, now double bound to a carbonyl at the central carbon, and we have two CH3OH molecules. This was simple. So let's try reversing that second reaction. Once again, identify the acetal or ketal carbon, the carbon that has two bonds to OR, and draw a carbonyl down the middle. Break the bond between that carbon and oxygen, and give each oxygen a hydrogen atom to reform the alcohol. What does that give us? We have a cyclohexane with a carbonyl now on that upper carbon, along with two molecules that consist of an isopropyl group bound to an oxygen, bound to the hydrogen that we added back in. One final trick before we look at the mechanisms. We said that acetals are relatively stable, and that means if they're difficult to attack, they can be used as protecting groups. When we want something else on the molecule to get attacked, but not an aldehyde or not the ketone. So how do we protect the carbonyl? We simply react it with two alcohols to form an acetal. Again, let's use the trick. Cut off the carbonyl. The carbon that has the carbonyl gets two oxygens, one for each of the alcohols. And then we attach the R group. And I'm purposely writing it like this. In this situation, we use two different alcohols, so we have two oxygen atoms bound to carbon and two R groups. But who said the R groups can't be attached to each other? What if I have a reaction where I have an alcohol and another alcohol, on the same molecule. Everything else still works exactly the same. A very common protecting group that you're going to see is an aldehyde or ketone reacting with ethylene glycol. Ethylene glycol, or 1,2-ethanediol, is a 2-carbon vicinal diol, meaning the alcohols are on neighboring carbons. If we react this with an aldehyde or ketone, we treat it the same exact way. Imagine that this is the first alcohol you add, this is the second alcohol, and they just happen to be bound to each other. How do we come up with a product? Take away the carbonyl carbon and redraw the skeleton. The carbon that used to hold the carbonyl is now bound to 2 oxygen atoms. Let's make 1 carbon green for the green oxygen and 1 carbon blue for the blue oxygen. Again, 2 different alcohols that we're adding, but the R group on the left is a blue carbon atom. The R group on the right is a green carbon atom, and they happen to be bound to each other. And a good way to remember that this is a protecting group is to add some eyes, and now it looks like a gas mask. Anytime you want to protect a carbonyl, give it a gas mask, proceed with your reaction, and then all you have to do is react this with acid to remove the protecting group. Because remember, all of these reactions are reversible. Be sure to join me in the next video where we look at the step-by-step mechanism for acetal and hemiacetal formation. You can find this entire video series along with the acetal practice quiz by visiting my website, leahforsci.com/acetal.